Welcome to the Walk in Truth Christian Fellowship Church broadcast on the WITRN network. Come join us as we study the Word of God together. Go get your Bible and let's see what the Holy Spirit is saying to us today.
And maybe you'll ask the age-old question, what must I do to be saved? So sit back, relax, get your coffee, tea, or milk, and enjoy the service. We're going to have scripture and prayer from Brother Stephen. We're going to have exaltation from Sister Kay. We're going to have a song, a solo song from Sister Frida, and then we'll move forward in the Word. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Steve, come on.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
All right. The scripture I have for us today is 3 John, starting at verse 3. And it reads, "For I rejoiced greatly when brethren came and testified of the truth that is in you, just as you walk in the truth. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth."
Yes.
And obviously, you guys probably know why I picked that scripture. But yet, always remember to walk in truth.
Amen.
But let's go ahead and bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for all the blessings that you bring us, Lord. We thank you that we could all gather today here, Lord, to worship your name and to glorify you, God. We also pray that you bless this wedding that we are doing later today, Lord. Bless the ceremony. May it be to your glory, God. We pray for the service as well, Lord. May you be with the speaker, Lord, that we may hear a word from you, Lord. Continue to help us to grow in the knowledge and the wisdom of your word, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
The vocal cords all messed up. Something going on.
Come on.
Let me tell y'all something. You know, for the last couple of weeks, I've been discouraged. I've been all over the place. I've been going through so much. I ain't trying to make this about me, but I'm finna tell you something about King Jesus.
All right.
All this stuff come at you. You know, when you're doing something for Christ, you get so many things come at you, right? You get discouraged. You be discontent. You be all this here. But the Lord said, Karen, I'm doing something great in you. I'm doing a new thing in you. But we got to realize when Jesus was going through, he always went and prayed to the Father, right? That's what I had to start doing. I had to start praying more. See, the Word say you got to keep praying in season and out of season. See, you can't give up. Because if he started something new in you, guess what? He's going to complete it. That's what the Word saying. So I don't know about y'all. But if you're going through, I'm telling you, it's great to be in a great church. It's great to know King Jesus. Y'all tell me when to sit down. It's great to know King Jesus. It's great to have somebody by your side. See, he want me to stay right here. I'm sorry. I don't know how to keep still, y'all. I'm going to try to stay right here. But it's something good about knowing Jesus. When you know Jesus, he said, come as you are. He said, you don't got to worry about changing nothing.
Right.
And see, some of us got to, I need to do this before I come. No, he said, come as you are.
Yeah.
I don't care if you drink, smoke, whatever you, looking at that porn stuff. You know, all that good stuff that we think is good stuff. I don't care if you're doing any of that. I'm not here to put my finger on anybody but myself. See, I see the Jesus in you. And some of us can't see the Jesus in ourselves. But I'll tell you something. You got him. Because if you didn't have him, you wouldn't be here. Amen. It's something about knowing him. Okay. It's something good about King Jesus.
Yes,
it's something good about it. I don't understand. When you're talking about Jesus, sometimes you just expect the crowd to be so overwhelmed because they got the spirit in them that you you want me saying, thank you, Jesus, hallelujah, Lord. I just thank you for today, Lord. I thank you for the food that you're giving me. I thank you for my life, Lord. I thank you for what I got on today, oh, Lord. Because in the Bible, it said, don't worry about what you're going to eat, what you're going to drink, what you look like, all that good stuff. But see, this morning, I bet everybody talking about, oh, I'm going to throw on this. I need to put on this here. But the Lord said, come as you are. When you come as you are, he'll use you just like you are. But he said you got something he can use. You can't choose what God gonna do through you. You already got what he wants. All you got to do is use it for his glory. So I'm gonna sit down because I see my pastor moving his head like that. Yeah, I just want you all to know that it is a pleasure to be before you this morning. May God continue to bless you. And remember, he's doing a new thing in you.
Amen.
Nobody likes to be like used and unappreciated, but to be used by the Lord is a totally different thing.
Yes.
So, you gave me my hands to reach out to man to show him your love and your perfect plan. You gave me my ears. I can hear your voice so clear. I can hear the cries of sinners, but cannot wipe away their tears. You gave me my voice to speak your word, to sing all your praises to those who've never heard. But with my eyes I see a need for more availability. I see hearts that have been broken, so many people to be free. Lord, I'm available to you. My will I give to you. I'll do what you say to use me, Lord, to show someone the way and enable me to say that my storage is empty and I am giving back to you all the tools you gave to me, my hands, my ears, my voice, my eyes, so you can use them as you please. I have emptied out my cup so that you can fill me up. Now I'm free and I just want to be more available to you. Lord, I'm available to you. My will I give to you. I'll do what you say to use me, Lord, to show someone the way and enable me to say, then my storage is empty and I am available. My storage is empty and I am available. My storage is empty and I am available to you.
Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Amen. You know, it's one thing to say you're available, and it's a whole other thing to be available. A lot of us go through life, oh, we're available, Lord, use us. But when the Lord knocks on your door, amen, the Lord decides to open your eyes and knock on your door, then you kind of say, well, Lord, not exactly right now. I got stuff to do. I got all kind of stuff to do. And normally what ends up happening is you get lost, because just like the soils, that one soil said the cares of the world choke it out. Mm-hmm. And so many times the cares of the world choke out what we're doing for the Lord today. You know, so we have to be cognizant of that, of our lives and how we conduct them. You know, but I want you to ask the person next to you something. I want you to say this person to them. Tell them you love them.
I love you.
Okay, say it like you mean it.
I love you.
Amen. And good. There you go. And just say to them, do you know who he is?
Do you know who he is?
Yes, you do. And then encourage them and say, don't let go.
Don't let go.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Depending on how we look at Jesus and who we think he is will determine how we deal with him. If he's just a prophet to you, you'll deal with him one way. If he's God to you, you'll deal with another way. If he's just a man to you with wisdom, you'll deal with another way. But it depends on how big your God is. Will depend how you reverence him and deal with him. So let's open up our Bibles. Let's open up our Bibles. Let's go to Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9. And go to verse 20. And I'm gonna start there, and then we're going to start, okay? Ready?
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. And Jesus said to them, who do you say that I am? And Peter answered, the Christ of God. And he strictly charged them not to tell this to no one, saying, the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed, and on the third day be raised. Hallelujah. And he said to all, if anyone will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. For whoever will save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses or forfeits himself and his soul? Amen.
Amen.
Who do you say? This passage starts off with that, and before that, they had went out. It was their training ground. In chapter 9, they went out and Jesus gave them power to cast out demons, to heal people. And he's getting them to the point. There's a transition when it comes down to this, because up until that point, if you read it carefully, they really didn't understand who Jesus was. Even though he did a lot of miracles in front of them, when it came to being in a boat and the storm come, they got scared. And he says, you faithless, you don't have any faith. You know, after watching him do all the miracles, you would think that you gained faith. But just because you're in the proximity of holiness don't mean you grasp it. Because holiness has to be revealed. But as Jesus was trying to reveal to them who he was, it comes to a point in all of our lives, that point. Who do you say that I am? He asked them at first, who do they say that I am? Who do they say that I am? Oh, well, some say you Elijah, some say you John the Baptist, some say you a prophet from God, but none of them would say that he's God. So who do you say that I am? Well, Peter, we know Peter didn't get this of his own thought. The Holy Spirit had to reveal it to him. Because Peter would put his foot in the mouth and say something real crazy in a minute. You know, Peter's like us. We're not above, once we get saved, of saying something stupid. So don't put on the past. Don't get so upset when the pastor say something out of turn, because we still growing too.
Come on.
So I'm just saying, I'm trying to set the scene for you. So now he asks, who do you say that? And he says, oh, you're the Christ of God. You're the Messiah. You're the one the Jews have been looking for. You're the one the world needs. Okay, I know. Okay, that's who I am. Now, I'm going to ask you, what you going to do with me? See, now that you identify who I am, you got to do something about it. See, until you identify who he really is, you really can't do nothing with him. So just like you did, all of us in this room maybe have said, he's the Messiah. Okay, what you going to do with him after that?
Okay.
How are you going to handle him? And see, the one thing he said, and if you get what he told them, that, okay, if you say, I'm going to tell you, you told me who I am, but let me tell you what it's going to cost you. See, think about this. We done did miracles, now you say it's going to cost me something to continue with you. See, God will let you go so far with him, and then at some point, you got to make a decision.
Yeah.
Okay.
He'll let you ride that thing out like a baby for a while. But eventually, he's going to say, you got to make a decision about who I am and who you are to me, and where do you want to go with me? And if you notice, in the first thing he said, it's the hardest thing for us to do, to deny oneself. To deny oneself. Well, Pastor, what do you mean by deny yourself? What he means by that is no, not deny yourself of eating a good meal and all that. He means deny yourself of your desires and what you want so you can follow him. You have to put what you want aside to figure out what he wants.
Mm-hmm.
And see, once you figure out what he wants, it doesn't necessarily go along with where you've been raised, where you come from, how much education you got. When you say you come into Christ and use me, you got to understand that's a declaration that you might not need to say if you're not serious. Because a lot of times, Brother Randy, what we do is have an idea where we want to go with God, and we want God to bless it and make it his will. God, I want to be a preacher. I want to be a singer. I want my gift to be used. But I want you to use your gift in Guatemala. I want you to use your gift down on Skid Row. Well, no, I wasn't thinking that. I wanted to be on television. You know, I sing like the best of them. But that ain't where I want you to be. Didn't you say that you knew who I was? If I'm the Messiah and your master and your God, you should be willing to go where I send you.
That's right.
Okay.
But a lot of us miss that. We go to follow and forget the denial part. Because follow to us means we're leading Jesus where we want to go.
Mm-hmm.
Have you met people like that? God is always talking to them.
Yeah.
Every 5 seconds.
Oh, yeah.
God told me this. God told me that. Really, it's them trying to lead God to where they want to go. Because if you notice what those people talk about, God never criticizes them.
That's good.
God only agrees with them. So that means God is following you. And if you want a genie, if you want that, you only got 3 wishes. If you want something else, witchcraft, they satanic. So God is here to save you. God is here. He's saying to them, y'all have identified who I am. Now you have to make a choice. If you're going to follow me, deny yourself. Decide that my way is better than your way. Pivot. And part of denial is repent.
That's right.
When you repent, you go from saying, God, I'm going my way, to say, God, I'm going your way. Okay? You're going to make a conscious, willful decision. This is not going to come down from lights in the sky, going to light up. This is a willful decision that you have to make. Because it's the will that made the decision that he's your God. Unlike Peter, we're moved by the Holy Spirit and God's revealing himself to us through scripture. And we have to come up with the same conclusion Peter came up with. That he is God. And he's worthy to be praised.
Yes.
And that we need to follow him. But first you have to be willing to deny yourself. And I get it. You know, who wants to deny themselves? Let's be honest. I want it my way all the time. Even when it seemed like it's not my way, I would still want it my way. So the issue is you deciding right now, today, that you're willing to go where God says, do what he tells you to do, and be his servant.
Amen.
And you being his servant, you're servant to everybody else in this world.
Yes.
You're going to become like Paul. I become all things, all people, that I might save some. It doesn't work for everybody. But your job is to cast the seed.
Yeah.
Knowing that the Bible tells us there's four kinds of soils. There's a soil that when you cast the seed because you're following God, it's going to be on hard-headed people who have hard hearts, and it's going to appear that it's not working. And then it's the other one that you're going to cast it upon them, and they are so caught up in the world that it'll just penetrate for a little while, and then it just dissipates. And then it's the ones who have the issues and the problems, and they let them take them over, and you plant the seed in them, and there's not much fruit because the root is not deep. The first problem come along, they blow them over. God, I follow you to the end of the earth, and here come a problem. Whoop, you done. You looking for the genie now. Well, God, didn't somebody tell? Somebody told me if I come to you, everything's going to be all right. I'm here to set that myth to a lie. Just because you come to Christ, everything is all right eternally, but you still may be going through hell on earth.
Yes.
The only difference is that we can handle it because we got Jesus.
Amen.
The only difference is we know who our hope is in.
That's right.
And where our hope is taking us. And our hope is not in ourselves, in our education, or our bank account. Our hope is in the risen Savior. See, our hope is not in a what, but it's in a person. And when I place my hope in that person, I agree with the exchange of the hope in him and what he's given me through salvation. I can walk in the power of the resurrection, considering other people more significant than ourselves. And then and only then am I denying myself and following him. But there's only one other problem. I not only got to deny myself, I got to pick up this thing called a cross. So hold on, Lord, let me get this straight. I've agreed to go where you told me to go. I've agreed to do what you tell me to do. But now you're telling me that I got to pick up a cross? I got to pick up a cross and follow you? Daily? The instrument of Roman death, I have to consider that as part of the equation of denying myself. I have to decide to put on the burden of the cross that might kill me and consider that before I can follow you. Yeah. In Acts chapter 9, at verse 16, I think it's verse 16. Is that right, Steve?
For I will show.
Uh-huh.
You may keep going.
Is that it?
Yep.
Go to Acts chapter 9, 16. I'll memorize them and have Steve read. Read 9, 16. Let's see what Paul said, what God told him, what he had of 9, 16. He's reading out of the ESV, y'all. All right, go ahead.
For I will show him.
For I will show him.
How much mm-hmm. he must suffer for the sake of my name.
So he showed him how much he must suffer for the sake of his name. Of his name. So I say, I know who you are. I know your name. And I'm going to do not deny myself. But God is saying for all of us who are going to follow him, he's going to show us how much he must suffer for his name. If you're not willing to pick up your cross and carry it daily and suffer for his name's sake, maybe you need to rethink this. This don't sound like no fun.
No, it doesn't.
I tell people all the time, behind that smile is a cross. Some of y'all will get that later. Behind my smile and my exuberance for the Lord is a denied cross. I've denied and crucified. He said, Paul, I'm going to show this man. He told that nice. I'm gonna tell you something. You don't think I can use him because of who he was, but he's the perfect person to use because guess what? When I use a person, it confounds the wise. See, to use a killer to be a preacher confounds the wise. Yeah. See, to deny yourself means also you don't look at people white like you look at people on the exterior. You look at every person as a soul that needs to be saved. Yeah. Or a soul that's saved that needs to be encouraged.
Yeah.
You see, we get past the superficial things because we picked up the cross.
Yeah.
And we've been told how much we must suffer. And most of our suffering through is suffering with each other and ourselves.
Yeah.
I have to deny myself and suffer through myself. I have to pick up the cross daily and say, because I denied myself, I'm going to carry the cross of righteousness, but myself keep calling. See, you still in a war with your old man.
Yeah.
You got to pick up your cross and follow him. And everybody has a different cross, but the cross is meant to kill you. The cross is meant to kill you because you can't get to resurrection until you die. The Bible talks about somewhere, talk about a seed, unless it falls to the ground, it dies right there. But it falls to the ground, it comes alive and germinates, and it'll produce much fruit. You have to be willing to understand this is a suffering, dying way. They get a whole bunch of amens when I heard the waiter. Thank you. So y'all think it's all popcorn and candy, let's get together, have fun. But no, that's not the real, that could be a part of it, but that's not your focus.
Right.
Your focus is individually denying and crucifying. Deny, crucify, and follow. Mm. Say it, deny,
deny,
crucify,
crucify,
and follow.
Follow.
So let's look what we got to crucify. Let's go to where I want to go. I don't know what I want to go to. But I'll think of it in a minute. Okay, go to Galatians. Galatians 5:24.
Already there.
And thank you. See, Spirit. Galatians 5:24-25. Let's see what he says about that. And then go to Romans 6:6. Let's go. Steve.
And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires.
So you need, let's slow down. Those who what? The operative word is what?
Belong.
Belong. If you don't belong, I'm not talking to you.
Okay.
See, this is an inside job. See, you ain't denied yourself. You don't try to run the crucifixion until you deny yourself. Because you won't understand what it's for. So only though, this is an in-house club deal. This is like belonging to Costco. Only deal you're going to get is that inside. The gas price is lower, if you're a member.
Right.
All right. Go ahead, read, Steve.
And if we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another.
So crucifixion puts us in a position where we can really enjoy each other.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because it says, let us not move in envy and jealousy. Let us move in love. Let us move in the fruit of the Spirit. It said move in the Spirit. See, when you crucify yourself, you can walk in the Spirit as he walked in the Spirit.
Yeah.
Because you're not moved by superficial things. You move about supernatural things.
Yeah.
Love is supernatural.
Yeah.
Lust is flesh. Now, they may feel the same at times, but they're not the same because the sacrificial love from Jesus is that true love.
Amen.
That love of the world is the fake love.
Mm-hmm.
Matter of fact, 1 John. Go to 1 John. Where am I, Steve? 1 John what? 9.
2.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Go to 1 John. And I want to go to 1 John where it says, Steve, you don't have it yet? 1 John 2:16. Look what the world has to offer for us.
For all that is in the world.
For all that is in the world.
The desires of the flesh and the desires of the eyes and pride of life.
So, go ahead.
Is not from the Father, but is from the world.
So all the world has the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life. But it mirrors the holiness of God. And it can confuse those who have denied themselves and started crucifying themselves. Because you're crucifying yourself to the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. That's what you're crucifying yourself from. Into the holiness of God. Okay, go back to Romans. Go read the Romans passage I told you. Romans 6:6, right?
Yep. We know that our old self was crucified with him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing.
So we know that we know. Now, the only reason you don't know is because you denied and you crucified and you're following. So he's talking to the people who know. We know that the old man has been crucified with Christ Jesus on the cross for those of us who have denied, crucified, and followed. See, when Jesus got on the cross, we have the capacity to get on the, not the same cross, but a like cross to deny ourselves. He ultimately denied himself and died on the cross and rose again. We vicariously participate in that. We get imputed righteousness. Okay? That's what we get. We don't actually have to have die on the Roman cross, but he says, I'm going to give you what I did to credit you so you can have a relationship with the Father.
Thank you, Lord.
You don't have to do what I did. But you have to be willing to do what I tell you to do.
Amen.
And what I tell you to do might not fit who you think you are, but who I'm trying to make you become.
Yeah.
I'm trying to conform you to my image.
Yeah.
And the only way you will be conformed into my image is not through the miracles, but through the suffering.
Yeah.
See, the more you suffer, the more you become like Christ.
Yeah.
The more you suffer, the more you can see other people suffering and have empathy and sympathy
yes.
for them and understand
yes.
that they're a soul that needs to be saved versus a drug addict, a dope dealer, a prostitute. Whatever label you want to put on them, they're still the holiness of God.
Yes.
That's the problem in the world. We got labels for everything, but we don't understand the label that God gives us.
Yes.
You are holy and righteous.
Mm-hmm.
And how you identify yourself with him will determine what you think holiness is. I bet you if I went around this room and asked them, with everybody in this room, what holiness is, you'll give me a different definition. And it doesn't mean that you're not denying yourself and crucifying yourself and following Christ. It's just that you're at your level of maturity. You're living up to the light that you have. As I've gone, I've developed what I believe holiness is. It's not what it used to be when I first started. Because when I first started, I thought it was an exterior thing. Holiness is an interior thing that has an effect on the exterior thing. See, you can, see, like I always talk about, I've never went to Saks Fifth Avenue, Macy's, or any of those stores, Stixbury full of us old folks, and seen a rack that said, or a dress rack that says church clothes. But we all grew up having church clothes. But there's no place you go in the store and say, I need your finest church clothes. And then I realized that it wasn't about what I wear, but it was about what I was wearing in my heart.
Yes.
What have I been converted into?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. And then when he put me on the road of suffering and denying, then what I found out is it's not all about me.
Right.
See, when you deny yourself, it becomes about everybody else but you.
Mm-hmm.
It's about that person sitting next to you that may need a hug from you. They may need a word of encouragement from you. They may need a word of correction from you. But every time you deal with somebody, you're coming from a good place in your heart because you're coming from the place that Jesus came from. They need a Savior. They need a Savior. And he say, pick up, follow me. And Jesus has a lot of these hard sayings. That's a hard saying. You know, he even talked about in Matthew, I'm not going to take you there, but, you know, at the end of the Sermon on the Mount, near the end, he was talking about the wide way and the narrow way. And he said, there's a way. Then he said, it seems right unto a man, but the way there is a death. And we know that that's the broad way. And the broad way lies to you. The broad way says heaven, but leads you to hell. But the narrow way is the way that Jesus said come, and we got the way to come, deny, crucify, and follow. That's the only way. Because he said, after that, you come to a door, and the door is narrow. And I'm the door. Then he tells you the only way, if you come up any other kind of way, you're like a thief and a robber. So he's the door, he's the way, he's the truth, he's the life, and you're required to search for the narrow door. You decide, you are required to deny, crucify, and follow. And with that, what I see is the majesty of God. I see that he could take a feeble-minded person like all of us in this room, and he can mold us into something the world can never match. There's no big eyes and little U's in Christ Jesus. We all part of the body. So all of us are important to God. But he says you all got to come the same way. Yes. You start off being whoever you are, but you are turning into whoever he wants you to be.
Yeah.
You're being conformed to his image. And let me tell you something. The more you mature in Christ, you say, how does that benefit me? Well, let me tell you how that will benefit you over there. What you decide to do with Christ here will determine how much you enjoy him over there. If you don't grow in God, you're going to pump your seat, you say. But you have to deal with him at that pump your seat level. But if you go ahead and mature yourself in Christ, instead of saying, I say we. Instead of using words, it's all about you, what I think, what I want, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Say we. We'll slow you down. Because we will quickly learn if you really talking about we or you still talking about you. The Lord told me, no, the Lord told you, where is it at in the scriptures? It ain't in the scriptures, it ain't God. That's 4,000 years of dealing with mankind. Now you done came up with something new. The Bible says at some point, rain, don't say, everybody got a song, everybody got a word, everybody got a message, everybody speak a tongue, and the answer is no, they don't. But they got one. And they try to make God, remember I said, what you do, you try to make God fit what you want to do. You hold the Bible up as a mirror to see if what you're saying match up with what the Word of God says. The Ten Commandments is a mirror. And once I say I violated one, I don't need to go no further. I need a Savior.
Amen.
So have you anybody in here farmed before? Raise your hand. Farm, you know, farmer. Farmer, farm, plant
count.
Crops, do stuff like that.
Does garden count?
Whatever, anything. Okay, have anybody ever, like, worked on a farm? Okay, well, I have had the pleasure of working on my grandfather's farm when I was growing up. And he had a plow horse named Nelly. And he would strap the plow to Nelly. And being a city boy, I was all excited, right? And my grandfather made it look good. He put the bit in the horse's mouth, which I was scared of, them big old teeth. And he said, boy, just go in, this mouth is soft. He opened his mouth, you put it in there. I learned how to do that. Then he said, this is how you hook up the plow. And it's a special way because the directions of the plow is giving back to you the reins. Then the middle of the plow is hooked up to the horse so the horse can pull the plow. And you put a part around you, and he's pulling you too. But the direction is dependent upon how well you understand how to govern what the horse is. The horse is more powerful than you.
Yeah.
And unless you hold the reins correctly, that horse will plow you all over the place. It don't care. When you say go, it's going to go. But you want to plow a straight line,
yeah,
a narrow line,
yeah,
a line that is straight all the way through. And if you let go of the plow while you're plowing, look back, look to the left, look to the right, you will lose the direction of the plow. You got to look straight ahead. Matter of fact, he wanted Nelly to look straight ahead. He put blinders on her.
Okay.
Because he didn't want her to get distracted. And I didn't even want to get distracted. So think about this. Nelly is leading me. I have denied my will for her will to go forward, but I still have a choice which way she go. You have a choice on how you're going to deal with God. God has a will for your life, and he wants you to go in a certain direction, but you have to decide. You got to put your blinders on and follow him. But again, you control it in a way because you are a free will agent. You can decide how much God you want every day. How much you're going to deny, how much you're going to crucify, how long you're going to follow.
Okay.
And see, with Nelly, it was like this. Y'all heard of G and Hall?
Yeah.
See, that's a foreign person. What G means going to the right. Hall means going to the left. And Nelly would understand verbal commands. You wouldn't even have to do anything. G, Hall, straighten. And she would do that based upon what she learned. She's conforming to me. I'm conforming to her. We've become in one machine plowing hundreds and hundreds of acres. And I was so excited by that. So I got behind the plow, city boy first time. I grab hold and Nelly took off, and it was more power than I was able to handle. I didn't realize that the plow itself was 200 pounds. So the plow went up, I went up with it, and instead of being on this side of the plow, I was on that side of the plow, dragging me and the plow. But you know what my grandfather said to me? He said, son, you got to hold on tight. You can't let go. If you're going to do this right, you're going to have to hold on. Remember the first question I asked you about letting go? Don't let go. You say, well, Pastor, come on now. You're talking about agriculture. Yeah, Jesus used a lot of agriculture too. If you don't hold on, you can't get down the road. Yeah, he'll be there. Nelly was still in her spot. She was doing what she wanted to do. She looked back at me like, what you doing? And then she stopped. And my grandfather dusted me off and I went back. And he said, now, son, whatever you do, don't let go. I don't care if you plow all over the place, but don't let go. You'll learn if you don't
let go.
Go to Luke chapter 9, verse 62. Read that, Steve.
Jesus said to him, no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God.
Amen. No one who has not denied, not crucified, and not followed, but decides to put their hand to the plow and look back at yesterday is not fit to go forward. See, you have to understand this, saints. A lot of y'all ask about purpose and all that stuff, and I'm getting kind of annoyed with that. Because this is the reason why. Let me tell you what your purpose is. Your purpose is one thing in particular. You need to get on what God is doing in the earth realm today. Mm-hmm. Not what he did 2,000 years ago.
Right.
Today. What 2,000 years ago was supposed to be your schoolmaster. Mm-hmm. What God is doing right now, Jesus is reconciling everything in heaven and everything in earth unto him.
Mm-hmm.
That means he does what he wants to do with his people at the time he wants to do it. You have to follow, but you can't let go. If you decide to put your hand to the plow and you a child of God and let go, I got to go back to the beginning and ask, have you denied, crucified, and decided to follow? Because you understand if you let go, there's only one way to go, is backwards. Not moving forward in Christ and standing still, waiting on a purpose, you actually going backwards. God is moving his thing forward without you. But that's by your will and your choice. See, it says, don't let go. See, the problem is, the letting go is an act of your will. To deny yourself is an act of your will. To crucify yourself under the power of the Holy Spirit is an act of your will. And to follow, you have to make that decision. So it's not this thing where he's going to come down and give you some nirvana. You have to see who he is and follow as you understand him. So the more light you have, the harder you can hold on to. Because what you're not going to look at is to the left or to the right. You're not going to look at what happened to you yesterday. That's why we say sing the song moving forward. We don't care where you came from. We want to send you on a course to where you know you're going.
Amen.
And let me tell you something about living out God's will in your life. Let me ask you something. When you do something that you conceive is wrong, how do you know that's not in God's will? Or his will is only when you happy? Let me tell you something. Go outside, look up, and tell you how high you can see. There's nothing that escapes God's will. He's used the negative things to make you who you are today. It wasn't the positive things, it's the negative things. So even sometimes when you do wrong, it's in God's will, because he wants you to understand the chastisement of that thing. And that corrects your course. So even when you do wrong, saints of God, I'm talking to you, the ones who hold on to the plow, don't let go of the plow because you just slipped and fell.
Come on.
Repent, get back up, and grab hold. Because he ain't going nowhere. He sends challenges your way and suffering your way and affliction your way to see if you're going to hold on. It's part of the plan. How can you get tough when you haven't been toughened? Don't let go. Don't let go. And we'll continue this later, but turn to somebody and say, don't let go. Amen. Because if you let go, you're not fit for the kingdom. There is no equivocation. You're not fit for the kingdom if you decide to let go. But even if you decide to let go, if you grab the reins too early, you still get saved. I don't want to discourage those who are playing with it. I just want to encourage you. You got to understand, there is a standard that God has set, Jesus set. And he said this. I didn't say that. He said if you let go, you're not fit for the kingdom. Your argument is with him, not with me. If he decided to let you in, he God. He can do what he want to do. But I don't think he going to violate his word. Amen? Let's pray. Oh, gracious Heavenly Father, I just thank you. I thank you for your word today. I thank you for showing us that we must not let go. Thank you, Lord, for showing us that we must deny, crucify, and follow. Lord, you've been telling us work the saints that for over 2,000 years, Lord. For some reason, we just forget. But Lord, teach us how to deny, crucify, and follow. Lord, teach us how to hold on. Teach us how to hold on. Teach us how to crucify ourselves daily. Teach us how to walk in the Spirit and not satisfy the flesh. Lord, it's in Jesus Christ's name I pray. And the saints say?
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you for listening to the Walk in Truth Radio Network broadcast. If this message has been a blessing to you, consider donating on your favorite platform. You can donate by looking in the description box and picking your favorite platform of choice, Venmo, Cash App, or PayPal. Continue listening. And your prayers are needed, welcomed, and appreciated.
Thank you for tuning in to the Walk in Truth Christian Fellowship Church broadcast on the WITRN network. Come join us every Sunday at 9 a.m. Central Standard Time for Sunday worship. Bible study is held on Tuesdays at 11 a.m. and 7 p.m. Central Standard Time. We are located at 3006 North Lindbergh Boulevard, Suite 711, St. Louis, Missouri, 63074. All are welcome, and we look forward to seeing you soon.